Hey guys, this is Austin. This is the Google Pixel 2, one of the most advanced smartphones on sale today, and it's powered by a Qualcomm Snapdragon 835 processor. Now this laptop beside me is also powered by that same mobile processor, and that actually is kind of a big deal. You guys might remember the original Microsoft Surface. Now it was powered by Windows RT, a specific version of Windows 8 that was meant to run on ARM processors, which are typically found in your phone. Now there are some advantages here, mostly with battery life, but also some smaller things like being able to have quicker standby time. However, the biggest issue was that it didn't run normal Windows apps, which, as you guys might know, is kind of important for a Windows computer. Now yes, you could run stuff from the Windows Store, but, well, no one wants to do that. However, on the surface, this looks to be a much better execution of that whole idea. And yes, I said Surface. That was a bad joke, wasn't it? So this is the HP MVX2, the very first in the next generation of Windows PCs that are going to be powered by Snapdragon processors. Now what makes these interesting is they actually do run Windows apps, which is very important, although it is with some caveats. But with promises of 20 plus hours of battery life, it might be worth the trade-off. Take a look at the specs, and it's going to look a little bit different. So it's powered by that Snapdragon 835, and it's backed up with 4 gigs of RAM and 128 gigs of storage. You know, the almost identical spec that you would find on a smartphone. What makes this kind of interesting is that even though it is in a tablet form factor, a lot of these Snapdragon PCs are going to be full-fledged laptops. But because it's being powered by a phone processor, as you can imagine, it's going to be a little bit thinner, a little bit quieter, or well, a lot quieter than pretty much any other laptop out there. Inside, we see how to navigate the Windows start screen, which is useful, as well as a bit of foam. But the real star of the show is the laptop. And wow, that's super, super thin. Wow, that actually looks pretty cool. So this is very similar to something like the Surface and the idea that pretty much everything is going to be in the tablet section, but it does come with a keyboard, which should be right here. So this is a little bit of a different design. So it's almost more like a case for the laptop, which just happens to have your keyboard as well as the trackpad. But when you actually put the whole thing together, it snaps on here, and then I think we can just fold it back. Yeah, so we get an adjustable kickstand, and that kind of looks like a Surface. Also included is going to be a stylus, again, kind of similar to the Surface, although the Surface actually I don't even think comes with the stylus anymore. But as you would expect with something like this, it is going to be a full touchscreen device, and that looks, again, exactly like the Surface. Last but not least, you're also going to be getting the power cable, which thankfully is going to be USB-C. Sorry, not last but not least. There's also a USB-C to USB-A dongle. Does this actually have any USB ports? That would be a no. Okay. So, this PC is going to be a little bit different from most. Now again, the Snapdragon PCs will be available in normal sort of laptop form factors. Now once you actually get into Windows, you'll find that, well, it looks exactly like Windows 10. Now it does have some limitations because it is using a Snapdragon processor, but on the other hand, one of the big advantages here is that we actually do have built-in LTE. So if I slide a SIM card in here, what we're getting here is essentially, well, exactly what you would expect with your smartphone. The idea is because the Snapdragon 835 has LTE and all the radios and stuff built in, it's as simple as adding a couple antenna, putting a SIM card slot, and you have a PC that in theory can be completely connected all the time. At least when it comes to initial impressions, the performance is pretty good on this guy. Just normal day-to-day stuff feels snappy. This guy ships running Windows 10S. Now that's fine, but I think pretty much everyone's going to want to upgrade to Windows 10 Pro, which is going to allow you to run third-party apps that are from outside the Windows Store. Now the issue here is that while this will run most apps, it's not going to run everything. It needs to be at the very least an x86 app, so no 64-bit stuff. And as far as driver support, this actually doesn't support standard Windows drivers. You do need to get specific ARM drivers, which at this point are basically non-existent. However, for most games, most apps, most programs, they're at least going to work somewhat on here out of the box. Benchmarking the MV is going to be a little bit difficult. So while it will run standard Windows apps that are x86 based, such as Geekbench 4, the issue is that it's running it in a compatibility mode. Now it means that it will work, but you're not going to be getting that full performance. And you can see that in the numbers. So take a look at the scores compared to a Snapdragon 835 phone, which is running on native code, and you're seeing that you're getting a little bit less than half the standard performance. It's fine, but you do notice a slowdown. But keep in mind that that's running in the x86 compatibility mode, basically the lowest performance option that you can get on this computer. If an app such as Geekbench is recompiled with Snapdragon in mind, you're probably going to be getting much more similar performance to what you actually get on Android. However, all of that being said, you have to keep in mind that while it's not going to be crazy high-end, you're getting pretty decent specs here. I mean, that Snapdragon 835 is going to give you 8 cores, 4 gigs of RAM, it's no slouch. One area this is really noticeable is when it comes to browsers. So Microsoft's Edge is natively compiled to work specifically on Snapdragon processors. So when you're on the web, everything feels snappy. It feels pretty much one-to-one like it would on your phone or pretty much any other laptop. However, download a third-party browser such as Chrome or Opera and things are noticeably slower. Run a quick JavaScript benchmark like Octane 2.0 and you can see that Edge absolutely destroys Opera's performance. Now part of that is of course due to the fact that there's some slight differences between how Edge and Opera perform, but running in that compatibility mode, while it will get an app to actually run on this guy, really does mean it's going to take a big hit to the performance. For me, the difference is enough that I would rather use Edge over any kind of third-party browser. Think even beyond the benchmarks. You're really gonna get something that is going to be noticeably slower when you do install something like Chrome or Opera that just wasn't designed with this in mind. It works, but just not very fast. But we do have the compatibility mode for a reason, and in theory, games will work. Although, the idea of how well they work is probably a little bit questionable when you consider that this is a phone processor running an emulator for Windows apps that is, yeah, let's just try it. First up, I want to give CSGO a try. As a slightly older game, it has the best chance of actually being able to run on such a low-end processor. Again, I say low-end, I mean, obviously you can play some pretty nice-looking games on Android, but Windows is a little bit more challenging. Your graphics hardware does not support all the features needed to run this game. Okay, not a great start. Let's try something else. Hey, okay, so next we have Rocket League. Now this is a game that again should in theory be able to be run on some sort of Snapdragon class hardware. Now my main question though is how the actual GPU drivers are going to work, because I mean this looks like normal, oh well it's slow. It's like slow Rocket League. It might work though. I'm not really entirely clear on how Microsoft is getting an x86 Windows app to run natively on an ARM processor. So it seems like they're doing something to be able to actually maybe emulate it, or I don't know if it's some kind of like hypervisor or something, but this actually looks like it might work. Now what's interesting to me is the idea that that's totally gonna go in. Great, good job guys. What's really interesting to me is the idea that this is definitely something that can be improved with software. Obviously there's going to be a limit on what a processor like the Snapdragon is capable of, but the idea that I'm actually playing a proper PC game here fully through emulation or whatever they're doing to actually make it work is impressive. Although, maybe not the greatest experience in the world. Next, I wanna try a game that actually should run on Snapdragon, the Windows 10 edition of Minecraft. Now the big difference between this and the Steam games I was trying earlier is the idea that the Steam games, well, they were just never meant to run on this kind of hardware. Whereas this is something that actually, I believe has actually been optimized to run on an ARM processor. If it hasn't, I can't tell because the performance is pretty much on point. To be fair, I don't think anyone is going to pick up a Snapdragon powered PC with the intent of turning it into a gaming computer. Now, there are a few things to keep in mind. First of all, this is the very first system that's shipping, so there's almost certainly going to be some more optimization, and the idea that this is going to be a pretty small and lightweight system that is able to actually do all this emulation is impressive. However, that being said, even in standard apps, the performance just isn't as good as it should be. You can definitely tell a difference between a native app and something that's going to be emulated. It's good, but there's more work to be done. There are definitely some advantages with going with a Snapdragon PC, though. One of the easiest ones to spot is going into sleep. So with an Intel system, usually it takes a few seconds between when you close the lid, wait for it to go to sleep, open it up. Whereas with this, it's like a phone. You hit the power button, it goes to sleep, hit it again, it wakes up. It's much, much faster. Having built-in LTE is nice as well. I think that's going to be a huge selling point for a ton of people. And all Snapdragon PCs, this as well as some of the laptops, are going to have it ready. So all you need to do is drop a SIM card in and it's going to be up and running. And it's nice to be able to be always connected between LTE and Wi-Fi. Now that being said, I'm actually not a huge fan of the Envy X2's design in particular. For me, the tablet stuff, it's nice, but it's not that much smaller than just a normal 13-inch laptop. But thankfully, there are going to be Snapdragon laptops as well. Probably the biggest selling point is going to be the battery life. So HP claims up to 22 hours of use on a charge, or 1,000 hours of connected standby, which for a PC is totally crazy. Now that's mostly thanks to the idea that the Snapdragon processor is usually found in phones, and I mean, even something that's going to be this small is going to give you a much, much larger battery than any phone will. However, all that being said, I haven't tested it yet, so I don't know exactly how long it's going to last, but if it gets anywhere close to those numbers, it is going to be a game changer. A Snapdragon PC makes a lot of sense for someone who wants an always connected computer that can run Windows apps, albeit a little bit slowly, and has solid battery life. Now with the HP Envy X2, it's a good system, but for me, it's hard to justify the $1,000 price tag. If it was somewhere in the neighborhood of like $700 or $800, I think I would be fine with it. But considering that it's going to be a little bit unoptimized right now, it's very expensive, and it doesn't even have the Snapdragon 845 yet, which I'm sure is going to be coming soon, it's kind of hard to recommend. That being said, I think there's a lot of potential in Snapdragon PCs. So, what do you guys think? Let me know in the comments below, and I will catch you in the next one.